Hello and welcome back to Tackling Tech. And I'm here with my good friend.
Hi, I'm Alex. I'm based out of Bergen in Norway, the friendship city of Seattle. And we have the same amazing weather there as well. That's nice having me here, Harjit.
Yeah, and we see you. I see you all the time, right? Yeah. So what do you focus on? What are your technology areas?
So I do somewhat a bit scattered all over. I do some devices, both Android, iOS, and Windows, some Mac, but a lot of Windows security and some Microsoft Purview. So protecting that information that's in the cloud and wherever it's actually located. So.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would like to learn a little bit more about Purview. Can you touch upon that a little bit?
So basically, the one of the main strengths about Purview is that you no longer have to rely on IT to lock down Windows to protect the core information at your company. Because for years and years, since the 90s, IT have been doing one thing particularly good, and that's using a lot of GPOs.
Yes.
So locking down Windows, making the user horrible experience for the end user.
Slowing things down.
Only to prevent them from copying files to a USB. That's basically what they wanted to do. And secondly, the benefit is that they didn't want to use the time to redeploy a PC because time is money.
Yes.
Well, today, realistically, you can redeploy a PC if it gets infected and it's rather smooth. So getting the device back up and running, it shouldn't matter if you have an Android, a Mac, iOS, or Windows.
Yeah.
You have a problem, you just redeploy and you're ready to go. Productivity is important, so make sure that it doesn't happen too often. Mm-hmm. So security matters, make sure that you reduce the amount of security. But productivity matters just as well. So shutting down productivity features in Windows to achieve security might be counterproductive.
Counterproductive, yeah.
As well, IT...
You're not solving a problem there. Yeah.
You're solving one problem
one by... One problem, but you're introducing another one, right?
Probably two. what's so fun about this story is that using Purview, you can protect the information so that if anyone get access to that information you're trying to protect intentionally,
sure,
you can protect it wherever it is.
Yes.
On whatever device it is, whatever cloud you have. So Microsoft Purview is probably the key to what the company and organizations and enterprises should be looking into for the next couple of years.
Okay, fantastic. So let's shift gears to like Windows core security or Windows security. What can you tell us about it? What are some of the features that you really, really think is amazing and that people should know more about?
There's no short answers for me, but I really liked Windows 10. And something that probably flew past a lot of people in the late 2019s was that they launched something called Secure Core PC.
Secure Core PC, okay.
Which was certified devices with all of these security features enabled from factory, shipped to directly to the customer or the end user. And this basically is the default standard in Windows 11. So mm-hmm. a lot of the virtualization-based security features that's part of the Secure Core PC is now part of Windows 11.
11.
So imagine that you are trying to isolate all the issues and you want to protect the kernel of Windows.
Sure.
Because we all talk about root malware like cryptovirus and phishing attacks, but we aren't talking that much about rootkits anymore.
Yes,
and
is very true, actually.
There's almost no talk about rootkits. There's almost no talk about memory infiltration, and there's certainly no talk about firmware attacks, but they are true. They are there as well. And in order to protect the integrity of your device, making sure that it's secure from booting until the user is presented with a sign-in to the desktop, you need to ensure that all of these features are enabled. Some of the reason why this haven't been a case until recently in Windows 11 is because it's been a taxation of the CPU.
Okay.
Now we have good CPUs. So the user isn't experiencing that much of a lag for all the security features.
Okay.
So all of the hidden gems in Windows, the core isolation, the potentially unwanted applications and all, basically just take a look at virtualization-based security.
VBS.
VBS.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's a great rundown on how this works. And I agree too. Like, I mean, you hit a point there, like, you know, you don't hear about the rootkit attacks as much anymore. And I think it's because of the enhancements and, you know, the hardware, right? The security in the hardware, right? And Windows 11.
They're still around.
They're still around.
So it's like we kind of flow over the top of COVID. Mm. It's still around, but it's not, no, the talk about it isn't that big. Sure. So it's still around, but they don't talk about it. And the reason is we have the cure, a vaccine. Mm. Now we have the security features to implement in Windows as well. Mm-hmm. So it's around, and you got to make sure that you got your vaccine. You need to use the VBS, you need to use all the security features so you are not the next target.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's why we say Windows 11 is, you know, security by default, is everything's turned on, things like that, right? You know, it sets the user immediately being secure, right? And we're doing now with remote work and stuff, right? We're shipping devices and they're doing autopilot, right? And getting their desktops, you know, provisions and stuff like that, and immediately they start working because all of that is already implemented.
That's true. And as a key point here is that when you talk about Windows, you get emotions. Some will say it's slow, some will get mad, some will get happy, some will get ignored. But the key here is that you need to take the productivity and security balance.
Yes.
So you can always find operating system that you let you lock down more.
Yeah.
But what do you need the device for then? Pen and paper is next.
True. Very true. Yeah, productivity is huge. You need people to do work, right?
That's true.
And not slow things down. And I like how you mentioned about GPOs earlier too. It's like, oh my God, that is just a bloat, right? And
a lot of customers I'm seeing that are now asking for help to manage their Mac inventory. Mm-hmm. The Mac inventory is growing. And one of the funny issues is that companies that start to manage Macs aren't buying that many more Macs.
Mm.
Because Mac in organization have been a wild goose. So there's been no management, hence no GPOs, and no loss of user experience. So,
but now we can manage Macs with Intune.
So IT admins are brushing dust off their old GPOs and find a way to limit Macs.
And even Windows GPOs, right? I mean, you, in organizations, right, you get a sysadmin that takes over from another one and so on because people leave or people get move on and stuff like that. And then they'll inherit, they're like, we have like hundreds of GPOs. What are these? What do they do? But no one dares like delete them or remove them or disable them because they're like afraid it might be doing something. So let's just leave it. Let's just add on even more.
I have to correct you. You mentioned 100?
No. Hundreds.
Thousands.
Okay.
So I visited a bank, a financial institution, and they had a firewall policy, a GPO that disabled firewall on Windows, which was enabled in Windows XP and never revisited. So there's happened something to the firewall in Windows since XP Vista 7, 8, 8.1, 8.1, Update 1, 10, and 11. But no one altered the GPO until certain someone came and said, we should turn this on.
It just kept going.
Kept going. So the kind of balance between security, I think there's one key that I want people to steal, borrow it, use it as much as possible. Mm-hmm. Less is more. You should do as much as needed. You should enable the security features that matters. And the less the user is hassled with it,
yes,
the more you get.
Yeah, and that's what we are trying to encourage people. Like, hey, don't bring your old baggage into Intune, right? Into your policies and your configurations, you know, settings and all that stuff, right? Start with what you need, right? One step at a time.
So true, so true.
So if you have thousands, you may only need 50. Who knows, right? Or maybe less than that. But yeah, there's some IT admins I've been talking to, you know, in the early stages, they were like, Yeah, but you know, we need a tool to bring them over and then we need to figure it out. Like, no, why do that?
I had a different customer who claimed that they needed the start menu to be looking the just precise exact way it used to. Mm-hmm. And I asked, do you do that on iPad? And they said,
no,
but that's different. And I, why? Why is that different? Can we do a managed home screen and put the layout and all the different apps the same way as you do on Windows? No, because that's different. And I say, I challenge them. Why is that different? It's a tool.
Yes.
So you're supposed to keep your employees productive.
Yes.
And if you don't trust them to find the apps in the start menu, do you trust them to find it on the iPad? And if you're worried that they're going to enter the settings in Windows, is the same going to happen on an iPad? So I'm not saying one is better than the other. but it's all about making sure that you treat every platform equal when it comes to security, user friendliness, and productivity.
Yep.
All the same.
Yeah. I'm glad you brought up about start menu. Like, that has been a big contention between, like, with a lot of people, right? Not so much from end users, to be honest with you. They, in my opinion, they could, you know, you give them whatever it is. It's a change. It's different. They'll adapt to it. But it's really like coming from the IT departments that say, hey, you know, our users are not going to like it. But when you start explaining like the concept of the start menu, the new start menu, why it's there, why is it in the middle? Mm-hmm. Yes, sure, you can move it. That's not a problem. Why is it? Because Windows 11 came about during work from home, during COVID, right? So what happened? People started working from home. They have large monitors.
That's so right? True.
So if you have your start menu all the way to the left, it's a long...
If you sit in the front row at the cinemas, you see James Bond open the door. It's like, boom, boom.
Yeah.
So centering the start menu is so smart because understanding that the concept of design, interaction design, human-machine interaction is so important. And you can see this in so many different ways. If you go consumer electronics, for those of you who do not know the Sonos speakers,
yeah.
If you take how much bigger the different sound bars are from the first to the second generation, it's not because it's fun, it's because the TV can get bigger.
Mm.
So in order for it not to look puny or to oversize the TV, it matches the size of the default TV size in the market. And the same happens for PC monitors as well. We've gone from 19 inch to 21 inch to 24 inch.
30 something inch, 40 something inch.
Dual 24, yeah. And now we're up to the ultra wide screens.
Yes.
So thinking that, why have Microsoft done this in this change? If you just think of this as some user unfriendliness, you're right, because it's just a change. But when you realize why they did the change, it's because the physical devices that Windows run on have changed.
Mm-hmm.
And it makes more sense to have it centered on an ultra-wide screen and on any screen.
Than to the left.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So exactly. Realizing the reason and understanding the change, then you realize that it's not to annoy the users.
It's not. It's a productive thing,
yep.
You know? And back to big productivity and all that stuff. So your thoughts about Copilot? Let's not.
Is that something new? All right, Copilot.
How do you feel about it? What do you think about it? What are the perceptions? And what do you think what the future holds?
So it's kind of hard to predict what the future holds when it comes to AI. But I think it's very important to mention that we are now sitting in 2024 chatting about AI as it's something new. Reality is that when you turn back time to the 1960s, some of the first computers that was invented was by Joseph Weizenbaum. And he programmed this computer with ELISA software to emulate a psychologist. And the basics about that was a lot of if and else statements, so that if a prompt on the screen were like, how are you doing, Harjeet? The computer will look for how are you doing? And based on the keywords, it would prompt me back with something, tell me more about Harjeet. And it was a really simple conversation computer, but that was basically AI as well. So the terms of AI is not something new, but I find it really interesting to talk about the large language model, which is the engine behind the modern AI the last two, three-ish years.
Right.
And that is the key of the AI we're talking about today. Mm-hmm. And I think it's safe to say that AI is not a buzzword. People thought that the cloud was a buzzword. Well, guess what?
Right.
It's there.
It's there.
It's still there. Yeah. Some thought that the smartphone was a buzz thing. Well, guess what? It's not. AI is here to stay, but it doesn't mean that it's going to be a AI the same way we talk about AI today.
Mm-hmm.
It means it could be just another productivity tool. It could be embedded into all sorts of things. We've seen cameras in the camera app on your phone.
Yes.
Have already used a lot of these AI, but they call it smart filter.
Smart filter,
they
yes.
They call it intelligent dynamic contrast. And that's AI as well. Who doesn't say that?
Even my phone right now, I use an iPhone 15, and it will try to adjust the focus.
That's true.
As you're trying to take a picture of something, it's like, I think you're trying to blur out the background, or you're trying to focus on this or that.
And you're so right.
Yeah.
So the definition of AI is a buzzword. Mm-hmm. The word is something that we are using a lot, but what it's going to look like tomorrow might be very different from what we use today. But the concept of AI is not new. Large language model is, and it's going to stick around. And it's not something that you can hope that's going to pass by.
No.
It's going to stay.
It's going to stay, and it's going to be in our daily lives, not just, you know, our, you know, day-to-day work technology areas, but even in your home life. You know, walking in, and it's going to know, like, hey, you know, you're always coming home at this time, or, you know, your refrigerator, for example. Hey, you know what? You seem to be missing these items that you normally use, and time to do your shopping. And, you know, that could connect with an online grocery store and just get all that stuff for you, you know?
Not going specific brands, but if you used any map services for your car, mm-hmm, or for your phone and say, hey, I want to go somewhere, it uses AI to calculate the best route.
Yes.
And it also get updates from where there have been traffic closure, traffic incidents, where there's something happening. That's definitely AI. Some would argue that it isn't, but then you have to philosophize what is. Mm-hmm. So in some sort, AI has been there for a really long time, but in different manners.
It's just come out more in your face now, more in the open, because the implementations are there, are deeper.
It understands our language.
Our language, exactly. Yeah. Fantastic. This is great. Did you have a great MVP summit?
It's been the best in so many years. I really love it, and I'm going to share you nothing about it.
NDA.
NDA.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you, RJ. Love this interview. This is awesome. Until next time.